Thank you for coming out tonight. We have John Hampton talking about Electron a little bit later, but first want to do any announcements. Anybody have any announcements, or I think, Joe, yep, you want to come up here and have a quick word?
I'm going to make this very short. My name is Sam Carter. I'm from Maryland. I came here a year ago. I got a 10-year-old company that's in the information security business. Largely what we do is online courses. But recently we've expanded into white hat phishing, send the email to the employee. We have a server dedicated to that, and my .NET developer, who's currently in Maryland, is on a fast track to become a playwright. And I've got to find a replacement, and I've given a bunch of my cards to John here. If anybody's interested, get in touch and I'll tell you the parameters. Thank you. Thank you very much.
All right, any other announcements or general questions or thoughts? All right, so I am John Calloway. We've got Clayton Hunt in the back. We are your hosts for this evening. Please join us on Meetup. Start discussions on the Meetup board. Feel free to post up anything that you feel is relevant. We're always looking for more speakers, topic ideas, anything like that. Tonight we will not have any raffle items. We typically will have raffle items each meetup, but we don't have any this time. Sorry. So please come back next month and we will have plenty of items to raffle off. Next month is caching in .NET Core. And then with that, we'll hand it over to John Hampton.
I thought there was going to be raffle items.
No, there are no raffle items.
Just kidding. All right, thanks for coming, guys. So we're going to talk, as John mentioned, about Electron tonight. I know this is a .NET user group, so I built the backend for this Electron app in .NET Core. I'm a JavaScript guy. We'll talk about that a little bit more. So that was a fun experience, getting back into the C# side of things. All this code's on GitHub, and there's a lot to talk about. Electron is pretty intense, and I'm new to it also. I'm more of a node and spending a lot of time in React and React Native right now. So Electron's completely new to me, but I wanted to dig into it and figure out what's going on. It's really cool. So I'm going to go through a few slides real quick just to paint a picture of what Electron is, what it brings to the table, just very high level stuff. And then we'll dig into some code. And we'll go through the code pretty quick. I'll try not to hold you guys up for more than an hour or so, but I fully intend on doing a blog post on this. In maybe 4 weeks or something like that, that recaps everything we did and then also kind of tightens up all the screws on this application. It's a beer journal application. Really couldn't think of a better idea than a beer journal app. So it doesn't really make a lot of sense on the desktop to have a beer journal application, but I think it works pretty well for this. So a little bit about me. I'm a technical architect at AgileThought. Here's my Twitter, John R. Hampton. Every once in a while I say things. My GitHub's up there. I'm also the co-organizer of the ReactJS Tampa Bay Meetup. We're nowhere near as high-tech as these guys, but we do a lot of cool stuff on React, React Native, Node. We usually host at the AgileThought office over on Rocky Point on the Tampa side of things. So please sign up if you guys are interested. We have some pretty good content. So what's Electron? Is anybody familiar with Electron? Anybody used it before? David used it before? Okay. So as I mentioned, it's completely new to me, but I've been pretty intrigued by it for a long time. It used to be called Atom Shell. It's maintained by GitHub. I'll put these slides up. I added some links on the slides, so if you guys want to click around to get some quick links to content, please feel free. It's all open source. The cool thing about it for me, being a JavaScript guy, is you're in a comfortable environment. You're using Node, HTML, CSS, and you build completely native desktop applications for OS X, Windows, and Linux. So if anybody's familiar with React Native, that's kind of what intrigued me about it. React Native, you can use JavaScript. You're writing with React, right? But you're also building full native iOS and Android applications, things like that. Electron really got me interested because the project I'm working on right now, there's a few of the guys here tonight, it's this huge web application. And we're constantly fighting with Edge, right? Electron gives us all of that web goodness that we're looking for, but it bundles up Node and Chromium inside of your application, so you don't have to worry about cross-browser concerns and things like that. So I jumped a little bit ahead, but the next point is it bundles Chromium, which is the open source part of Chrome, and Node with its V8 engine inside of it. So you get all that stuff. So you have a full Node runtime running right there, access to all the Node APIs, which is pretty cool. Then the output is a native binary that uses Node and Chromium internally. So why Electron, right? I struggled with this a little bit when I got started because it felt like I'm building a web app and I'm trying to shove it inside of something, right? But I took a step back and the app I'm going to show you guys tonight looks like a website. And really that was just me not knowing what to do, right? This is my first time in Electron. How is this thing supposed to look? And I'll show you guys some apps that are built with Electron. In my next iteration of this, I'm going to try to tailor this thing to look more like a native experience on OS X. I don't have a Windows machine, so some of the code in here is tailored for OS X. There's some nuances between Windows. But I'm going to try to make the next one a Windows version and an OS X version. It's basically the binaries that you build out are a little bit different. Some of the menuing is different because you want to have that Windows look and feel on Windows, just like you want iOS on iOS, Android on Android, that kind of thing. So the big win for Electron is you get access to the native desktop platform, right? So I listed a bunch of stuff here, but just file system, taskbar, dock icons, recent docs, window title bars, native notifications, power management, network connectivity, etc. That's a ton of stuff, right? That you can use where if you're on the web, you might have some problems interacting with all those full APIs. Also access to the box you're running on. So any process that the app running user, any process I have access to as the user, Electron has access to. And then as I mentioned earlier, full access to the Node API. So all supported syntax, made a note about common JS modules. The app is also offline by default, which is an interesting take when you're used to building web applications. Also no cross-browser concerns, you're always targeting Chrome, so you don't have to worry about any of that stuff. And then last, you can get your product into new distribution channels. And I'll show you guys when I get to the point about some of the apps that are out in the world that are built with Electron, that kind of opened my eyes a little bit. Well, wow, this is so easy to use and go grab. And it doesn't make sense for every app, but the Beer Journal being one of those, I think. But for some of the apps I'll demo, I'll show you guys, you'll get an idea of why. All right, so high level, Electron, how things work. You have two main processes, and a process is extended from Node's process object, and they kind of split it up into a main process and a renderer process. So your main process is kind of your event controller, where it owns everything. Carlos?
Sorry.
I'm just kidding. So you have your main process. There's only one of these processes. It's headless, it spawns new renderer processes, okay? These are just a few bullet points of things I thought were interesting. So, creates and manages browser windows. I spelled browser wrong, that's awesome, I just saw that. Actually, it's a Brower window. It's kind of a new thing that Node's putting out. I would dig into that, it's pretty cool. Electron, I have twin boys, okay? I did this really late, so I'm sorry. Also, this is the Electron app entry point, and as I mentioned, it serves as the event controller. So we'll get into the events a little bit later. The render process, there can be n instances of renderers, right? As I was reading through the documentation, it seems like the renderers are kind of like this is your content, your web page that you're presenting, right? So imagine your main kind of process fires up and you want to go to a login screen, that's a renderer. And it can talk back and forth to the main process, which handles all of your events and has a lot of access to the Electron APIs. And the renderer has access to different APIs, and I'll show you guys some of that in a minute. Where your UI content will live. So then down here at the bottom, put this here to kind of show how we talk between the two. Yeah, it sets the mood for me, man, whatever you guys want to do. So the main renderer processes can communicate via IPC, which is just inter-process communication. So if you guys are familiar with that, Electron gives you a nice API that makes that very, very easy. And it's just an instance of Node's event emitter. So if you're familiar with Node, this is a very comfortable development environment. So let me quick segue. I overly complicated this because I jammed React into Electron just to see what it would do and how it would work. So I wasn't intending on doing that, but I did that. And I'm glad I did because it's cool. You get a lot of cool React stuff out of it, but now I've also tightly coupled React inside of Electron, right? Which I didn't need to do. And then the IPC, just my last point, it works like most PubSub APIs. We good, guys?
Good.
So I did this. I was gonna put all the APIs in here, and I got tired of copy pasting, so I didn't. They're not all in here. But this shows you some of the APIs that the main process has access to and the render process has access to, and then the shared part in the middle is what both processes have access to. So this is a lot of them, but it's not all of them. So I put a link at the bottom. I was running out of room here too. I didn't want to. This slide was already kind of cluttered, so I put a link to the full API list down in the bottom corner. But you can see you get lots of cool stuff. Like the main process, you have access to dialog windows. You have access to IPC main. On the render process side, you have access to IPC render, which is the IPC's counterpart for those processes. So I know that's a lot of stuff, but we'll see some code and hopefully it makes a little sense. So here are some apps built with Electron. I use a lot of these. I use Postman every day, and I didn't know Postman was built with Electron at first. I was super jazzed when I found out it was. And so is VS Code. I don't know if any of you guys, I'm a WebStorm guy, but I've been using Visual Studio Code a little bit because I started writing .NET Core. Visual Studio Code is a pretty awesome editor, and it's all built with Electron, which was amazing to me. The guy in the bottom left corner, if you're not familiar with that, is Brave. It's a pretty slick browser. And then we have Atom, another editor like VS Code, if you guys aren't familiar with that. And then Gitkraken at the top, which is a kind of a Git client you can use to manage all of your Git stuff. So pretty cool. So this blew my mind when I started thinking about, wow, this is how they built all these major apps around production with tons of users. I got pretty excited about it. You guys, any questions on the apps or anything? I'm trying to talk fast so I can get through all this. And then enough slides, show me some code. All right, so let me jump over to this real quick. All right, so this is on my GitHub. Can you guys see this okay? So I did this a little differently than I've done other meetups. I have branches on this GitHub repo. It's a private repo. I'll flip it to public tonight or tomorrow or whatever. And I have there's a .NET St. Pete UI repo and a .NET St. Pete API repo. So the API is the .NET Core API, and it just has one branch. Actually, two branches: a master branch and then a make async branch that I was doing before we started. I might have broke some stuff, so I didn't merge that back in yet. And then the UI branch, I have a bunch of stuff. So we have initial, intro, master, and then steps 1 through 5. So what I did, intro is just a quick high level stuff. Initial kind of shows us some prereqs of how to get started. And then steps 1 through 5 have the concept of kind of like how we got here. So you can fork this repo, clone the repo. And the thought is step one, you have working code, but it's just some very basic, hey, Node works. Step two is, hey, we have Electron working. Step three is building React scripts inside of Electron. And then step four is tightening that up. And then step five is the full beer journal application. So I'll try to go through all this stuff, but if I was gonna focus more on the Electron side than the .NET Core side, I'll just show you guys how the API is responding. I'm a Node guy, so I was going to redo the API in Node, but I just ran out of time. I'm much more familiar with that than .NET Core at this point, but I'm pretty intrigued by .NET Core because you can run it on macOS or Linux, and that was one of my big hangups with C#. So let me just go through this. Please stop me anytime. I'm just going to go through quick and talk really fast, but if you guys want to stop me, just please say so. So this is just a little bit of information, right? So we're building a beer journal app with Electron, .NET Core, and Mongo. Well, our application is pretty basic, but it has simple authorization, meaning just email and password auth, talking to a .NET Core API. We're using libraries like bcrypt to hash passwords. We're using just basic JSON web token authentication, and we're persisting our data in Mongo. So the thought is you can create new beer journal entries, edit and review existing entries. The edit part actually doesn't work yet. I didn't finish the update piece, so there's like a what's missing section at the very end of step five, and I'll show you guys that at the end. So the presentation is focused on Mac. I don't have Windows machine. I might get Callaway to work with me and help port the next iteration of it over to Windows so that we have working software for both pieces, for both platforms. So I just wrote out, by the end of the presentation, what we have, right? We'll have installed all the Electron dependencies, initialized the new Electron project, ran and debugged the app, wired up simple authentication, added React scripts, which I did this for hot module reloading, basically. It was one of the big reasons I wanted to see if this would work. We added a native menu, we'll display native notifications, we'll display JavaScript-based notifications, we'll wire up React to present data, we'll use material design, which, is anybody familiar with material design? Anybody use that? Callaway? Okay. So I'm a big fan when I'm building web apps or like an Android mobile app, but I'm very familiar with it, so I used it on this. So it's a desktop app, but it looks like a web app because I'm using material design, right? So I don't know if the concept's really poured over or not. I'm not a UX guy, so I'd be interested to hear what you guys think. And then we will have persisted an entry in Mongo, and we'll have displayed some entries. So let me jump over to the initial branch. Since nobody's live, does anybody plan on like coding along while I do this? Probably not, right? Okay. So I put some this is mostly for afterwards, right? If you guys want to dive in. Prerequisites. I'm assuming people have GitHub accounts. You have Git installed. I said install Node with NVM, since I'm a Mac guy. NVM is Node Version Manager, if you guys aren't familiar with it. It's a super helpful tool to manage different versions of Node very easily through the terminal. And then just some steps, fork this repo, and then clone the repo, CD into the repo, and then check out the initial branch, and I guess read the initial branch, because there's nothing to really, this is the initial branch, sorry. Just walk through this and kind of get started. So what I did was a how we got here approach. So really to get started, all we do for Electron is we initialize run npm init, which initializes our application. And then we set main to our source app.js file. And then we just have to run an npm install of Electron and save that as a dev dependency. So we jump over to some code and show you guys what that looks like. We got some funky resolution issues, just one sec. Well, it looks kind of okay. Seems like presentation mode doesn't want to get out of full screen maybe first. There we go. Okay. Can you guys see that okay? Is that good? All right. So let me jump over to the terminal real quick. I'm going to go into the UI and I'm going to check out this initial branch. Okay. All right. So I'm just going to do a little bit of jumping back and forth here from GitHub. Let me walk through all the steps first, and I'll jump over and show you guys code. And if anybody doesn't like that, just let me know. So the other thing we did is we added a start script here, and this is an npm start script, if you guys aren't familiar with Node. And it just says, hey, Node, run source app, and then create source app, which just literally logs to the console, Electron app right now, right? So this is kind of if you're coding along with this and you're going through the stuff, this is really just a way to get started and let us know that everything is working properly, right? So in the terminal, that's really hard to see. Is that better? You guys see that okay? Good? Okay. So you can see that we just did Electron app. That's the console log. So really, we have nothing to do with Electron yet. We're literally just proving out that things are working properly, right? So let's go back over to WebStorm. And you can see in our package.json, we have Electron installed as a dev dependency. We have our main set to source app.js. We have our start script set. We have a test script that's really not doing anything. It's just letting us know there's no tests in place. And then our app file, our app.js just has a log to the console with Electron app. So our node modules is pretty light at this, well, fairly light at this point, because I'm still looking at step five modules. But at this point, our only dependency is Electron, right? So those are step five modules. I didn't clear all that stuff out. All right, so let's jump over to the step two branch. And this branch, it kind of starts off slow, guys. Or sorry, step one branch. It kind of starts off slow, but I did that intentionally just to go at a really slow pace and kind of show exactly what we're doing. So in this step, we're going from node, just a pure basic node application, to an initialized Electron application. So all we did to get to this point, we already have Electron installed. We're going to update our start script to point to Electron dot, which is just using our main entry, our main attribute in our package.json, and firing up Electron against that. And then we're going to update our app.js file to bootstrap Electron. So again, all this code's already in the step one branch. I just copied it up here so we could easily see it. All we're doing is we're requiring in Electron. And then right underneath of that, we're using the structuring assignment. If you guys are familiar with JavaScript or Node or ES6 patterns, all that's doing is basically like saying const app equals electron.app, that kind of thing. Just destructuring that key out of that Electron object. Then we initialize an Electron app window. We wire up our app on ready. So you guys remember I was talking about the main process, and it's the event controller. It acts as an event controller. These are some of the events. So the app on ready, we create a new Brower window, not browser, it's definitely Brower. Set the height and width to 500. A little bit later, we'll set it to resizable false so people can't mess with stuff. And then we load, this is the cool part. So we say app window load URL, and we're just using some using some string interpolation here to build out this file string. So I put a note that we have access to the file system. So we're building out, we're basically pointing to this HTML file on the file system based on the directory we're in right now. And the last thing is just a manage the app window closed event. When it's closed, we log to the console and we set app window equal to null so it can be garbage collected. So then we have an initial beer journal feature. I put some links to the raw content of these files, so you can copy paste them as you move along. And then the next step is just to make sure that Electron is up and running. So let's jump over to WebStorm, and let's check out the step one branch. All right, and let's run npm start. And if I didn't break anything, we should have a pretty cool Electron app that says beer me. Pretty basic, but we have a full native application at this point with minimal coding, so it's pretty easy to get up and running with Electron, which is cool too. So up here we have a bunch of menu options that look familiar to maybe like Safari developer tools, that kind of thing. But we can toggle developer tools, zoom in, zoom out, enter full screen. You kind of get a nice little subset of menu items at this point for your app without even having to do anything. Excuse me, one caveat, this goes away as soon as you build your own menu. So right now, I can actually do Command-Option-I, just like I was in Chrome on the Mac, and I can open up the developer tools, and I can actually see that I logged beer journal feature. That's coming from my actual code. I'll show you that in just a second. And this is doing a console.log also, but it's console.logging from the render process, so that's going to the web, the render process, right, where the UI is versus the main process, which is what Electron owns. So just a quick little caveat. You'll see that as I dig into the code a little bit more. So let me show you this real quick. So you can see we have app.js has updated just like the code we showed on GitHub. And then we have our beer journal feature, okay? And this guy has a index.js file, a beer journal CSS file, and an HTML file. So let's look at those real quick. So the CSS is just super basic, right? Use Carolina Blue, I'm a Tar Heels fan, for our H2 tags. Our beer journal HTML is super basic, but it's just this is just pure HTML5 at this point, right? And we have link tags, we have script tags requiring our index file. And then all index is doing is logging beer journal feature. So this was the same log we did before that was logging out to the console, the terminal window. Now we're actually logging to the web console because this is an official renderer process at this point. And then our package.json has been updated, as I mentioned, with just the Electron dot. And that's pretty much it to get us to this point. So let me jump over to step two was step ahead of myself. Okay. So this step, we get a little bit into the nuts and bolts of the native side, okay? So we're actually going to create a menu on this piece. And this is where things get a little macOS specific. It's easy code to check for what platform you're on, but really the specific piece is on the submenu right here. You see where it says label about. The about role is a macOS concept where you can go into your app and click, you know, Electron about or beer journal about. In Electron, that's purely an OS X concept. So this would not work on Windows. It's pretty easy to code around that. You have access to a platform object. You can say platform.process and figure out where you are basically. So we're going to build this menu. I'll show you guys what that looks like. One of the things I want to note, where it says const product name equals app.getName, there's no line numbers, but the third line of code down, that's an Electron convention, an OS X convention to get the main menu item. When you're devving, this is always going to say Electron, but you can specify this inside of your package.json file. I think I might have mistyped this. I don't recall if product name is an OS X specific feature or if I was just talking about again. So I'll find that out and make that clarification. I can't imagine Windows wouldn't give us that. I'm not sure. So adding this entry to our package.json, calling this beer journal, gives our app, gives our Electron the ability to go grab our product name using the app.getName function. So next we're going to update app.js to display our menu. And displaying a menu is super easy. What I did, I created an app menu file so that we could easily require that in. And the app.js file would stay super clean. And right where we say, right underneath where we're creating a new browser window, build application menu, that's all the code we have to do to build our menu. So it's basically building a menu from template, and then I'll show you guys the menu template code in just a minute. And that gives us a really, really clean way to create our applications menu. That's it for this branch. Let me go back to WebStorm and show you guys the code. All right, so let's check out, we gotta kill Electron. Let's check out step two. All right. Okay. So again, you can see this is the code I was just showing you guys with our app menu. We're still pointing to our beer journal entry point. And really the new code is this guy right here. So building a menu is pretty straightforward. We have an array of objects basically, right? So we have a label for this particular thing. This is the label at the very top. So our Electron, our app name, if we were in production, would say beer journal. But in dev, we're just gonna always say Electron. We're adding submenu items to that, which is our about. And then super easy to add a separator. There's the concept of different roles for menus, and separator is one of those roles. We just get a nice native look and feel line separator. And then I added a quit. And inside of macOS, you can use accelerators. I don't know if this is a Windows concept or not. Maybe you Windows guys could help answer that. But here you can set your commands. So I can do command Q, which is a standard macOS keyboard shortcut basically to close down the application. I think the same kind of concept exists on the Windows side of things. So let me fire this up and show you guys what it looks like. And you're gonna notice one thing right away about our app is our menu item. Our menu at the top is gone, right? So we had all of that kind of default development stuff out of the box that Electron gave us and all those default menu items. But now since I'm telling Electron what to build for my menu, we only have what's there. So I can't even, at this point, I can't even do things like Command Option I to open developer tools, all that stuff is gone. So there's no keyboard shortcut or accelerator that exists anymore at this point for me to open the dev tools.
Can you put that stuff on the end of your object?
You can, absolutely. And there's a little slick way to do it too. I'll show you in the next step. But here's our about menu. And I know it's really hard to see, but it says Electron version 1.4.whatever. And then you can also do, I'm going to do command Q, hopefully that works, it does, cool, to close the application. So just a real super quick walkthrough of menus. So Calvin, to your point, you could build, like, you could append to your array based off the, you know, based off your node environment variable, something like that, and say, hey, if I'm in development, add these things. But there's also a really slick API that lets you do that. I'll actually show you that in the next branch. You guys, I'm moving really quick, but any questions so far? You guys digging this so far?
Yeah. How do you set up, like, you said your accelerator. Command Q is for Mac. You have, I would assume, all four for Windows.
Yep.
How do you make sure that you're consistent across those? Or does this kind of track that way for you?
So do you mean consistent across, like, platforms?
Correct.
Yeah, so there's a platform object or a platform function that you can invoke that lets you actually get back if you're on Windows or Darwin for OS X or whatever, right? So you can get that back and build specific menus for that platform. Is that what you're asking?
No, that's perfect.
Okay. It's actually, I think it's platf. I forget exactly what it is. It's in here for sure.
No, that's right. I mean, I'm just more curious about the concept.
Yeah, absolutely. So with Electron, the point, at least from what I'm seeing so far, is to stay as platform specific as possible, right? So give everybody that experience that they're used to. I think it's process.platform or something like that. But there's lots of examples I've seen. I have one in here I can show you, where you can basically just write some simple conditional stuff or conditionally concatenate menu options based on the specific platform, things like that, or maybe you'd have a constant with, like, your accelerator keys, so you'd have some code reuse, you know what I mean? That says if it's Windows, do Alt+F4, I think you said, or Mac, Command Q, that kind of thing. Make sense? Okay, so step three, this is where I completely deviated from my intended approach, right? I was coding this thing, and I was like, man, I'm in React all day, every day. The project we're doing, we have a forked version of Create React App that which is the parent, the owner of React Scripts. So is anybody familiar with React Scripts before I go on this crazy tangent? Aaron, Carl, I know the people we work with are. Jordan, okay. So React Scripts is a dependency you can add to your React projects. Facebook created it, and it's it basically introduces, like, a zero configuration approach, right? So you have a React application. We use Webpack to bundle our application. Every app that you spin up, you will, for the most part, have a similar configuration, right? Unit testing frameworks, code coverage reports, linting functionality, all of that stuff. React Scripts abstracts all of that away as a dependency of your project. So you can install this dependency and then literally run npm test, and all your testing just works because it's a node process that lives behind the scenes. It's all abstracted away. It's called zero configuration approach. I'm a big fan, and I was like, wow, that'd be really, really cool to do that in this. So I went off on this tangent and spent a lot of time to come up to figure out how the heck this works. Luckily, there were some cool guys that had already started to do this, so I just kind of hacked up what they did a little bit and lifted some of their code and added some of my own and all that good stuff. But the cool thing about this is now when we fire up our application, we'll get Webpack dev server up and running inside of Electron. So we get things like hot module reloading and all of that cool stuff that I've become accustomed to on the web. You get all of that inside of Electron. So quick caveat, I'm not saying this is the right thing to do because you're kind of muddying the waters because you're jamming React into Electron. And it's not that hard to do. It's actually pretty straightforward. But it also felt a little weird to me. I try to stay away from frameworks when I can. This felt weird because I was jamming in more frameworks. I almost added in Redux too. I'm like, well, now I'm just going overboard, maybe, right? Yeah.
How does the build work? Like, I assume that they have to build, like,
Yep. So that's so what part of my what's missing is the actual build process. But what the Webpack piece, so it builds a binary file for you based on the platform you want to build for. So I specifically said I'm building for OS X. So it gave me this nice Electron bundle with Node, Chromium inside of it that's ready to rock and roll for OS X. So Windows would do the same thing. Linux should get the same thing.
So you have to do that before you start your application?
Yeah, well, when you actually run the NPM install for Electron, I believe was the step that asks you that.
Can you select that you want all three?
I don't. Actually, Carlos, I don't remember, man. Let me let's go check real quick.
I was curious what like your build pipeline will be if you have to do that and then your Webpack and all that.
Yep. So I don't.
Do you have to be on the specific, like, do you have to be on Windows to build the executable for Windows, or can you build all of them in under one OS?
I think you. So I don't know that. I didn't get that far into it. I don't think this install. There's a step that I'm forgetting here, because this obviously doesn't do anything related to that. So there's definitely a step I'm forgetting. But
is there a init or something afterwards?
So I didn't put any of that in here because we haven't really done anything about anything with initializing. But there is a step where you can specify this is the platform that I want. It's been a while since I did the very initial part of it, so it's just slipping my mind. And I didn't actually get to the build piece, which is what I really, really wanted to get to, because that's the exciting part, right? How do we build this thing? So that's definitely missing, and I'll try to cover that in the blog post, which is kind of like part two to this, where, because this is really me exploring this whole technology, right? So I don't know how everything works yet, but I want to figure it out, so the blog post will be part two with all the rest of the answers.
Do you know if
it,
sorry.
What's up? You guys ask me questions all day. Correct. It bundles Node and Chromium inside of your binary. Yep, so it's got all that stuff inside of it.
So is the intention here to build an application specific to each environment, or is it to build an application that senses the environment that you're running on, and then you just build multiple builds?
Yeah, like,
what's the strategy?
That's a really good question, Aaron. I think it's a little bit of both. So, because you're writing code that is conditionally doing things based on the platform, but you're also building a binary that's specific to that platform. So I think it's a little bit of both.
Okay.
Yeah, or in React Native too, you can kind of do the same thing. You have like .iOS files, .Android files, but your wrapper is one thing, right? And you kind of split out, it has two different projects inside of it. I think that's where this is going to go. So I'm not entirely sure, but.
That's going to have much more across code than
Yeah, I would think so too, because there's nothing in here that I saw that's like build a specific window dot Windows file or dot OSX file, right? It's all just build this application. And as I get into more of the component pieces of this, I think that's what's going to give us the native look and feel. At least that's what I'm hoping. There's a dialogue I'll show you guys in a little while. So you log into the Beer Journal app. And if you don't put any credentials in, it pops up with a native notification that says email and password are required. So I didn't have to do anything for that. I just said dialogue, show error box, right? My assumption is that's going to look really good on OS X and really good on Windows without having to do anything, which is kind of the React Native kind of thought process too. They give us components that just look good in both places. And there's some stuff we have to write ourselves to look custom. I think it's going to be the same approach. So I don't have all the answers. Stay tuned, please, because I'm really excited to get the blog post out. And finish this up so we really can build a full, you know, see this thing full circle and see everything that it does. All right, anything else, Carlos? Aaron? I work with these guys. They ask me questions all day. I'm just kidding.
Love you.
I love you too. They're good. They're really good. They're really good questions. So for React scripts, how do we get this thing working, right? This really had me scratching my head. So the first thing we do is install React scripts as a dependency. And this piece is exactly what you would do on the web, okay? So if anybody has any questions about this in general, just let me know. So we install React DOM. This gives us all of our React stuff we're gonna use and our React scripts. And I'm really not trying to push React, sorry. I know it right now, so it felt like an easy way to, and I was also super curious how this would work. So you're kind of seeing me hack up some stuff and have some fun and try to figure out how this works. So the standard kind of flow when you're using React scripts is it exposes start, build, test, eject, which you can eject your config into your project from behind the scenes. Then our Electron script is exactly the same right now. I just wanted to call that out. So some things I did is I updated my main to point to Electron-app. So since I'm muddying the waters with React a little bit, I wanted to be very explicit on what app.js is. So it's our Electron app. And then I prefixed app menu with Electron dash also, just to make things super clear. So for those guys that are familiar with React scripts, you know our project starts up at localhost 3000, right? Kind of the default port. This was a big aha moment for me, was we just change our app window load URL to point to localhost 3000. And then whatever Webpack is serving up, that's the content we see inside of our Electron app. I think, Callaway, this was your question about DevTools. This is a super easy way to check based off what environment we're in. So right now it's just checking if we're not in production. Then go ahead and open the DevTools for us. So the DevTools will always be there while you're developing. And then we added a handle all windows closed event. This is the process.platform that I was trying to remember the exact name for. And this is where we're going to, if all the windows are closed, then if we're on OS X, then quit the application. And this was, I read about this a little bit. It seemed like this was kind of an OS X convention, so I just wanted to follow this. This was in one of the Electron kind of bootstrap examples on Electron's website. So I lifted that code and did the same thing. So in order to use React scripts, it expects a public directory to be at the root of your project with an index.html file. This index.html file is where all of your script tags, link tags, all of that stuff gets injected. Then we're going to create a React entry point. We're going to add a new component for app, and then we're going to make sure that React is up and running. And there's some notes I put down at the bottom, but let me show you those. Show you what the code actually looks like first. This means validate my step. I think this was step 3. Yep. You guys good so far? All right, check that out. All right, so let's go ahead and fire this up. So you're gonna see a few things. One of them is that the browser is gonna open up, which is really interesting, right? So this is one of my things that I put in my notes down here. Wait, do what? This is really late when I did this. Sorry, it's not a fun at the time. Our app opened in the browser, right? So this is React scripts doing its thing. So React scripts uses Webpack Dev Server. Webpack Dev Server has a cool feature where when you fire it up, it bundles your app and it opens a browser window for you pointed to localhost 3000. So that is super, super cool, but it doesn't help us in the Electron world because we don't want that up and running, right? So now we have a browser window with our application inside of it, which isn't very helpful for us. So let me just open a new tab real quick, and I'm gonna do npm run Electron, which is our Electron script we created. So now you can see this is back to our Electron world, right? So the web thing is still running over there with Webpack Dev Server, but we're able to see the exact same code inside of our Electron application, and we have our dev tools back, which is pretty cool. So the next step, I'm gonna get rid of the browser window completely, because that's kinda, isn't super helpful for this. But I wanted to show you guys this real quick.
So the code that you put in to get the dev tools back earlier, mm-hmm. it's automatically popping them open?
It's automatically popping the dev tools open.
If you close them accidentally,
yep.
Can you get them back?
That's a really good question. I have not tried that, Clayton. Let's see, Command Option I. Nope. So that seems pretty interesting, right? So maybe we could build, maybe back to Callaway's point, we could build a nice little only dev only menu option, something like that, that'll let you open those back up. Because that's super annoying, right? I do that all the time. And the keyboard shortcuts aren't working for that. So yeah, that's a good good question. All right, so anything else so far? I know there's a lot. It's a lot of different concepts, but I wanted to kind of try to cover all this stuff. So everybody cool? Any questions? Nothing? All right, so let's jump to step 4.
I have a question.
Sure.
You said you shoved React into the environment.
I did. Let me show you that code, actually. Sorry.
What else would you use?
I skipped right over that code, too, didn't I? So what else would you use? You would just use basic, you would write node modules, just your index.js file would be a simple node module, and you would have basic HTML, just an HTML5 application, no frameworks to present. And you could even go super old school and just do document, get element by ID, stuff like that.
So you could even use jQuery, you could use raw JavaScript, it's really anything
yeah.
that renders out.
You could use anything.
Angular 4.
Or Angular? Yeah. Angular, yeah. If you're, that's your kind of, that's what you're in.
TypeScript?
All right, that's it, I'm gonna leave. We don't say TypeScript. So you could do, and I said shoving it in, and it really, I probably should have framed it like that. It's really not that overwhelming. So it looks your index.js file has transformed. This is step 4 code, so I won't talk about everything. If you guys are seeing files you don't expect to see yet, but this looks very familiar, right? From React stuff that we do, right? So we're just rendering our app component in this. And this is where you would also wire up Redux. If any of you guys are familiar with Redux, this is where we would hook up our provider and stuff like that. And then our index.js file is just the basic app component that gets spit out by React scripts, just modified it a little bit to say, welcome to React Electron. I might even have seen this in the example that I based this off of online. And so it's super basic stuff. There's not even any routing or anything right now. So we'll add some routing a little bit later. Yes, sir.
So how do you communicate? So, because you run to node, let's say I need to do something in the file stream. How does the front communicate in the back?
Carlos, that is an excellent question. So you use, Electron has an API for inter-process communication, and that's how you communicate, that's how they want you to communicate, through your main and your renderer processes. So basically, we've just created a render process using React. So to communicate, I'll show you guys that, and I think it's step 5. We can communicate from React back to Electron through that IPC. So it's basically pub sub at that point. So you fire off an event. I do it when I get the access token in my React application because I log in, and then I send it back to the Electron main process and say store this access token. And then there's the concept of asynchronous and synchronous pub sub through those processes.
Is there like a response or is it?
Yeah. Okay. So you can do an async response or a synchronous response. So you kind of get that you get the two-way synchronous communication, or you get asynchronous communication, and then your child process would subscribe to that response, that kind of deal. So it got a little tricky in React doing that because of the lifecycle events. I had everything async, and then I went to synchronous because I was trying, like in component did mount, right? So React has lifecycle events, if you guys are familiar with that. Component did mount is where you usually go do asynchronous type stuff to kind of bootstrap your component. That's where I was trying to go grab the token that I had stored earlier in the file system, right? So I was trying to grab that guy, and I was running into a lot of trouble because it was asynchronous code, and I was trying to use the token before I had the token, and really, really interesting problems. Any other questions? I'm gonna show you guys React scripts real quick. Oh, this is step 4 stuff. Let me walk through step 4 real quick.
Where's the binary at
then? I'm sorry, the what?
You're generating the binary?
So nope, so that's part of I mentioned earlier, the what's missing part. So this doesn't actually bundle anything up or build the binary for OS X. What Webpack is doing is building a bundle right now for our JavaScript. Think of it as like a single page application. Webpack is building that, and then Electron is serving that up for us. But at this point, we're not doing anything with actually building a production ready app. So there's no binaries for OS X or anything built at this point. This is just, at this point, we're just local devving. Does that make sense?
And you were gonna address that next month or whatever? Is that what
yeah, so doing? So my blog post.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm gonna wrap up with all that stuff. There's so much stuff, I just literally could not jam it all into tonight's session. And I barely scratched the surface on Electron. There's so much stuff to cover. So the build thing is a big piece to me. And then at the end, if you guys have any feedback on what you'd like to see that's missing, things I can hone in on, I'll absolutely make sure those are in the blog post.
Do you have any take on the closed source aspect of that build piece yet, or still?
On the actual binary?
The motivation of doing the closed, build the executable so it's closed source at that point? I mean,
mean, any thoughts on that, or find out as we go?
Yeah, I think kind of find out as we go. That's I think that's kind of intriguing why people are using it for like, you know, Postman, VS Code, that kind of stuff. It's definitely a different model though, right? It's which has me intrigued a little bit. Again, I haven't really built an app yet where I would say I'm doing a side job or something like that where I would want to sell them on this technology. Feels more like a largely distributed application like VS Code or Postman, something like that. I think Postman actually started as a website that turned into a native application. So I'm curious. It's a really good question though. Carlos, what's up?
Any project that doesn't require like the higher performance of a native application would be worth doing like this.
Yeah. Well, and
it's cross-platform much more easy.
It is. The thing I liked about it too was the not worrying about all the different browsers, right? Like we're struggling with some stuff on our project right now. It's a huge project that I think Electron would actually help us solve as far as UX designs and especially interacting with large state objects that we want to persist somewhere that we don't want to just dump in local storage, right? So that's some of the stuff that intrigues me about that. So step four. So this we're going to do a little bit of house cleaning for our dev process. I focused on the dev process. I think a lot because in my day-to-day, I'm focused on helping making our developers' lives better. So I think I really focused on that, and if I was giving this to our development team to run with as a baseline, what would they expect to have, right? That kind of thing. So this is using a custom React scripts. We're extending our load URL to account for production builds. So this is the one thing that's like I'm kind of staging for the eventual binary creation. Which points to, instead of pointing to localhost, it can potentially point to the bundle that's the static bundle that's generated. That's the one thing that's kind of staged for the binary build. And then we add a process management tool because if you notice, I had to fire up React scripts, and then in a separate terminal window, I fired up Electron. That's not a very good experience. So I read about this online. I put some links. A guy did a really cool tutorial about exactly what I was trying to do. So I followed what he did pretty much to a T on this, and it's pretty cool, but there's definitely some kinks that need to be worked out. But I think it's a pretty cool baseline. And I also am using another guy has forked React scripts and started a custom React scripts, which has a lot of the stuff that React scripts is missing, like compiling SAS. Giving us the option to not open the browser, the little things that Facebook didn't give us out of the box, this guy did, and it saved me from creating my own, so I used his library. So we're going to add this custom React scripts dependency. We're going to add Foreman, Node Foreman, which is a really cool process management tool, and then we're going to update our package.json to use all this new stuff. We're going to update our homepage attribute to account for relative pathing. And there's a link right there to building for relative paths in React scripts, if you guys want to read about that a little bit more. We're going to create a start Electron module that Foreman will use. We're going to create a proc file for Foreman to use. We're going to update our Electron application to account for local dev and production builds. This is what I mentioned earlier. So this is going to point to our static index.html file. Or our Webpack dev server. Okay, so we're using node environment variables process environment variables to switch this around a little bit. And then our app window is a little more dynamic and takes in load URL. So again, know this is a lot, but this really helps frame our development process. So let me just quickly show you guys what that looks like. And then I'll fire it up and we can see what the difference is. So real quick inside of here in React scripts, in the package.json, I'm still using React scripts, but the biggest change I made is I created start now invokes Foreman on port 3000. Start React fires up the React application. Start Electron fires up Electron. Runs my start Electron configuration. And then Electron is still the same, and actually that's what actually invokes the Electron process. So start Electron, this is a little bit confusing. I'm going to gloss through this real quick. And you guys can look at this code a little bit later on your own time if you're interested in what it's doing. But this is a kind of a cool process I found for how to using Foreman to how to wait for one thing, one process to finish firing up and then to invoke another one. So all this does is fire up the Webpack dev server for us. And then when that's done, it fires off Electron. So it just gives us a little more of a streamlined. This is the house cleaning part that I mentioned. Let me just go ahead and jump over to this branch. I'm already on step 4. Let me run npm install real quick to swap out that other dependency. Hopefully that's pretty quick. They have pretty good Wi-Fi here. Okay, all right, so then let's run this guy. So you can still run npm start. And now you can see that inside of our terminal window, we're getting a lot of output saying start our development server, start Electron. You can also see Webpack dev server output. And then you can see our app is running at localhost 3000, but the browser did not open. And all we have down here is our Electron application with our dev tools, which is what we were expecting. So we still see our React application here, but just a little more of a streamlined dev process. So that's all step 4 really is. I just want to tighten things up a little bit and give you guys a quick walkthrough. Any questions on any of that stuff? It's kind of a deviation from React and Electron, but I think it's important to learn how to streamline the dev process, especially on big teams. That's a big part of this stuff. So if you're using this in production, this is probably something that you would, or using this on a team at work, this is probably something you would want to consider. All right, so let's jump to step 5, which is the nuts and bolts of the beer journal application. And this, there's a ton of code in this, right? So I wrote a lot of stuff to try to get this, and the app doesn't really do too much, but there's just a lot of code behind the scenes. I haven't even shown you guys .NET Core yet. It's already 8 o'clock. So I'll go through this really quick. I'll show you guys the app, and then just stop me if you have any questions. Okay, so real quick what we did, we enhanced this with React Router so that we have routing inside of our React application and we have routing inside the Electron shell. Lots of different ways to do that. I picked React Router just because I was going down the React route at this time. We are going to update our window size to look a little bit better. We're not going full screen, but we have a little bit of a bigger area to show the application. The user also can't resize the window at this point. Also added a library to write to the file system and store information. So I read a blog about different ways to handle this inside of Electron. And the guy had a really cool store concept. So I lifted that and tweaked it for the storage utility. I said future use, but I'm actually using it in here. It's just not bulletproof at this point. But it's code to look at and kind of hope spur some conversations. This is, Carlos, your question about communication. So now our app, I'm sorry? Oh, yeah. Is that better?
Yeah.
All right, so now in here, we're also gonna use inter-process communication to talk from our main process to our renderer process. And I'll show you that. Here's an example of some of those events that are gonna be inside of our Electron app now. I don't know why I air quoted that, it is the Electron app. So one of them is login successful. So this is asynchronous. On login successful, we're going to set our access token, just a simple JWT base64 encoded access token in the file system. On logout, we're gonna null that out. And then we're gonna have a synchronous event where some render process can request the access token and we go get the access token and synchronously return that to them. So they literally, it's like invoking a function call and you get the result of that invoking that function, which will be our token. We're gonna enhance app index to handle login. We're gonna clean up some files. We're gonna rename beer journal to use more of a React component, Pascal casing. We're gonna delete some stuff again. We're gonna add some constants. So I really tried to paint a picture here of how you could set this up for like QA, dev, production, all that kind of stuff. I didn't do anything dynamic based off the environment, but I laid the foundation for that with an endpoints and environment.js. The thought behind environment.js is you would expose your API path for dev or QA or prod, something to that effect. Right now it's just hard-coded to my localhost. We're gonna add a loading component, which gives us some feedback to the user. We're going to add a login component. We're going to add fetch and storage utilities. So this is interesting. So I'm building this app. I'm like, oh boy, I need to go talk to the server. How do I do that, right? So since I was in React, or sorry, since I'm in Node, I use Node Fetch, which is a library I'm very familiar with to make these asynchronous requests. As I'm digging into Electron a little bit more, it looks like they actually have a library that does this called Client Request. So the next iteration of this, I'm going to try to wipe Fetch. I don't know if I'll do that for the blog. Depends on what you guys are interested in. But try to get rid of Fetch and use more Electron APIs. I found myself questioning, what am I doing? I don't really know what I'm doing. I'm just doing everything for the web. I should probably spend a little more time digging into what Electron has to offer. As far as can I solve these problems with Electron versus something else, right? Coming from the web, that was a very interesting conversation or thought. I was talking to myself, I guess. So we'll fire up the app next, and I'll show you guys some code. And then we also need to fire up our API in Mongo. So this is the .NET core piece. So again, it's a .NET user group, right? So I did the API in .NET core. I wasn't going to talk too much about that. I don't know how much interest. Watch, you guys are probably all way more interested in .NET core than Electron. The code for this is on GitHub, and I'll make the repo public after the meetup is over. Does anybody want to see any of this code? I know it's already after 8, but Callaway? All right. So, .NET core. All right. So, I did not do this in Node, and I'm very new back to the C# world. I was a C# guy a long time ago, but dove head over heels into Node, and I honestly haven't ever looked back. I'm sorry? It is. That's why I did this. Yeah. Thank you. Thanks, Carl. I meant no offense.
I agree with him, but
yeah. Yeah, I seriously mean I mean not in no negative way whatsoever. Just it's my personal preference. I know. But still, to be respectful, I have no problems with C#. Just it's not my forte, so it was interesting getting back into it. I'm so deep in JavaScript, and I came into this, I can do this in JavaScript very quickly. And I came into this and I was like, wow, it's kind of cool actually to get back into a technology you don't know anything about because you're brand new, right? So Callaway helped me find some things I was doing wrong in here, and I really appreciate that. So there's to-dos throughout this, but my basic pattern, again, I don't know if this is the best. Callaway said he was okay with it, didn't necessarily hate what I was doing. Maybe that's my phrasing. But we're basically just, we're creating JWTs in here and
can you zoom in?
Oh yeah, sorry.
Thank you.
Let me get rid of this side panel here. Yep, sorry guys. Better? Okay. So the screen probably pretty hard to see.
So is this really just as an overall, is this just web API?
Yeah, this is just ASP.NET Core.
Okay.
Yep. So it's just C#, right? Using some of the .NET Core packages, or using all .NET Core packages, I should say. So it's literally just web API, but the .NET Core piece to it. Is anybody using .NET Core prime time at this point? A little bit? We have a big C# domain right now that we're looking at .NET Core to migrate to. I've heard mixed things. I see really good metrics, but some people say it's not ready for prime time. I don't really know what to think. So I was curious what you guys had to say about it. So the API is honestly pretty basic. There's a couple routes. Let me show you the routes we have in place. That's probably a good place to start. And all I did to get started with this is I went to .NET Core's website. I followed their OSX instructions on how to get started, their macOS instructions on how to get started. It scaffolded up this nice project for me using the Yeoman generator. So a lot of the stuff like Dockerfile Nano, all that stuff came with the project. Project.json was there. I added a bunch of libraries to do things like encryption or hashing of the passwords, like bcrypt, which I'm familiar with from the Node world. And then the Mongo C# driver, I added that. So I'm not using any framework or anything. I'm just using the Mongo C# driver directly. Let's see, what else did I do? Inside of the app settings, I added some some JWT issuer options, a Mongo connection string, and a lot of this I just read tutorials. I'm not familiar with the best practices in, especially in .NET Core, but primarily in the C# realm right now. So any comments you guys have, I would love for people to check out this repo, and please submit PRs or tell me what you think about the code, because I would love to improve this and use it as like a baseline API to kind of get started with stuff. So you're not going to hurt my feelings if you say something is terrible. So we have two main controllers: journal controller to do CRUD for our journal entries, and a user controller to do basically just creating and reading of our users. So you can log in, create a new user, you can create a new user and you can log in and validate the credentials for that user and then get a token back for that user. So this is the journal piece, and all of this is locked down. The whole API is locked down at this point, except for the two routes on the user controller, because anonymous people should be able to log in, and also I've allowed anonymous people to create users at this point. And a quick side note, the app doesn't let you create users. I'm using Postman to do that, but that could be a nice extension down the road. So I have a journal repository, and I have a user repository. Again, I don't know if these are the best patterns. I just kind of followed what Mongo suggested to do and went with that for this first cut of this. You can post a journal entry at this point. You can't update a journal entry. I mentioned that earlier. And you get all the entries, or you can get one entry at this point. And this I haven't really built this out yet. The git's not even. This is the git all. Sorry. So there's not a git by ID at this point either inside of the controller repo. Or journal controller. Excuse me. Over in the user controller, there's a little more code in here that's of interest. Let me zoom out just a little bit. That's still okay to see in the back. Is good? Okay. So in the user controller, this is where we anonymously let people create, and we're using the from body attribute so we can pull the payload out of the request body to create that. We do some simple validation here, validating that the email and password are actually there. We're also hashing our password before we save it, so we're not saving pure text. Then we go grab the user. Sorry, we validate that the user does not already exist. If it does, we ask, hey, have you already registered? Something like that. Then we actually create our user and then return the created user back to the client. When you log in, a little bit of a different flow when you log in. First of all, we verify that the email and password exist. And then let me jump into this verify piece real quick. This is kind of the cool part here. So this is where we go grab the user from the database based off email address. Did you give us one that already exists? That kind of thing. Pretty basic stuff. Excuse me. And then we verify the username. Verify the password against the hashed passwords. We're using the bcrypt library for that, which is nice. And then if everything is cool, we return a new claim. I know the claims, it was more of like a .NET concept, but one of the intros to JWT I was reading for .NET Core suggested this approach, so I rolled with it. I don't think, Callaway, you didn't have any major objections to this approach. So please check out the repo, C# guys, and give me some feedback. I'd appreciate it. So let's jump over to Postman real quick, and I will create a user against this API. Let me go fire everything up actually real fast. So for this, these instructions are on the API README. I already have Mongo installed, but it gives you a little bit of information about Mongo. So I'm just running Mongo from the terminal, and then the API, I'm just going to run .NET run, which is kind of this is the cool thing about C#. Oh, .NET shut unexpectedly. That's not cool. One of the cool things I liked about .NET Core was it gave me the kind of that node feel running from the terminal. Oh, it gave me that error because it's already running. So that was kind of a cool experience for me for node guys, if you're interested in that. Kind of gives you that warm and fuzzy where you can run from the terminal and do stuff. So let me go ahead and create this guy. So I'm going to create a user with my email and my super secure password of 123. And if all goes well, then we will get a created user back. Let me show you guys what that looks like. So this is just the default default information that we're returning back that I got back from .NET Core. I didn't modify this at all. It's including the password, which you wouldn't really do in production, right? You don't want to return the hash password back. But I just rolled with this for example purposes so that we all could see what's going on. So when you log in, let me just do this again so you can see what that looks like with a clean token. So I'm logging in with the same credentials I just created. And I'm getting my access token back, and my access token expires in 18,000 seconds. I think it is 5 hours, maybe. And then let me show you this. This guy isn't letting me zoom. Let me see if I can zoom real quick on this. This is called Studio 3T. It's one of my favorite Mongo UIs. I don't see a scroll, a zoom on this, but all this is, all that I wanted to show you guys was I had one entry in my Mongo database user collection. Now I have two, right? So just proving that I wasn't faking it out on what I was doing. All right, so let me jump back over to the Electron side of things. And let's look at step 5 real quick. And we can talk about that. All right, step 5. OK, so let me fire this up, and then we'll talk about the code. All right, so we get our same standard approach. We get our developer tools. Hopefully you guys can see this OK. We get our beer journal application. So here's our app. Looks very much like a website, at least in my opinion. All I did was throw a background inside of this that I found on some free stock image website. And then I did a material design paper login for the email and password. What are you guys more interested in seeing? You want to see the app real quick, or do you want to see the code first? Any preference?
App.
Okay. All right. So I did a few things in here. If you click login, this is an example of the native dialog. So this is very OS X specific, Mac OS specific. On the Windows side, again, this is just invoking the main process where I'm saying, hey, main process, dialog, show error box, right? And there's no, I didn't configure anything else. I just sent some text. There's no title. I didn't do anything like that. But that's an example of what you can get with on the native side. And then I also, as soon as I click OK, you're going to see the website. So check out the bottom right corner. So now here is a little snack bar saying email and password expired. So I wanted to show how you get kind of that web, the web goodness inside of here, or you can use the native piece, right? So whatever your preference is. If you try to log in with bad credentials, my password is 123, I'm just going to use 12. Then down here at the bottom, you saw the quick loading overlay flash real quick. You get the login failed message at the bottom. You can see the standard stuff that you would be seeing inside of your console when you have an error. I'm logging that to the console, could not post data. It's invalid credentials, basically, is what's happening at this point. So none of this, just to recap, everything that you're seeing here, we could have done with just pure Electron, right? There's nothing really that React gives us so far, except for the ease of presentation, I guess, at this point. Electron is doing all the stuff, right? So if I actually log in to the application, we get a loading overlay, and then this is the beer journal, right? So it's super, super basic, nothing really fancy here. Just to quickly walk through what we have. So we have a little logout option over here. This is the material design piece I was talking about, where I don't know if this really makes sense, right? But I did it because I wasn't sure what else to do. So I styled everything using material design light. And this is just a standard material design light navigation. This is actually right off one of the material design light templates. I just kind of lifted their code. It's kind of my go-to starting point when I do talks. So I did a very similar web piece, and I wanted to see how that looked inside of Electron. So the user can log out. You can add a new beer. I'm a big fan of Cigar City, so let's do Cigar City, White Oak. I can't spell. Hi-Li. Let's say that I drank that beer today. I didn't. And then it was really good. So you can hit save. Real quick loading overlay. And then again, you get the JS snack bar, which is just a simple node. functionality that's popping that snack bar up. That has nothing to do with React, by the way. It's just hooking into the DOM. It's the same one we use in our project to work, if it looks familiar to you guys. And you can go back through and review the beers that you have added. And then you can click the plus to wipe it out and do a new one. So again, super basic demo application with just some basic functionality there. And then you can actually log out, and that clears your token through the IPC inter-process communication flow and wipes your token back out. So that's pretty much the app. Let me show you guys some code. It's 8:20. I'll try to go through the code quick. All right, so we've seen all that this stuff. Let me show you guys what Electron app looks like now. I'll try to focus on the Electron piece and show you how the login communicates, that kind of thing. So I showed all this up on the screen earlier, but the cool part is how we're communicating, in my opinion. So we've created three, can you guys see that okay? Zoom a little. I'm in presentation mode, Callaway. I don't know if I can zoom at this point. Can I? Windows zoom? Nope, it didn't help. All right, so sorry, it's hard to read. Just what we've had here is we have on our main, IPC main is our main process. This is, we've hooked into this and we've added some pub sub, so we've subscribed to some events. On login successful, we're gonna expect arg to be our access token. And we're going to set that in our file system using storage. And again, storage is a utility that it's a custom utility that we wrote. We're going to handle logout requests, which is when we clicked logout just a second ago. What's that? Make it bigger? I think it's on presentation mode. Let me see if I can. I go enter full screen. I know it's hard to see. Sorry guys, it's not letting me zoom at this point. Does anybody know a trick I'm missing, maybe?
Maybe increase font size.
Okay. Let me see if I come back out and come back in. It gives me anything funky.
No, that's worse.
There you go. Is that a little better? A little better?
Yeah.
All right.
There's a checkbox, I think, in WebStorm we use where it allows you to zoom in and out of the text. I mean, don't worry about it now.
Okay. Yeah, sorry, I'm not sure. Sorry, it's hard to see, guys. But the three things we're looking at, these things right here, these three little blocks of code. Login successful, which is what sets our access token. Request logout, which is what clears our access token. And then we have a very nice example of a synchronous event at the bottom, which is request access token, which is using event.return value, which is the two-way synchronous communication. Back to our whoever called this, right? So back to our renderer process. So let me show you what that code looks like.
Where's that?
This guy right here that you guys probably can't see, the very last guy. So he's doing right here an event.return value, which is basically just saying this is a synchronous event, and we're on the event set the return value, and he immediately responds.
So if it's not a synchronous event, you can't return anything?
No, if it's not a synchronous event, you can do async, but you're just firing off another, you're publishing another event that your renderer process is going to listen for. So let's go look at what that actually looks like. Okay, so let me show you this first. So this guy right here, handle login. This is where we're doing our dialog show message box. So this dialog, if you guys remember the little circles I did earlier, dialog is an API that's exposed on the main process. We're in the render, bless you, Aaron. We're in the render process, and we want to invoke that dialog. So there's two ways to do that. I could have fired off an asynchronous event back to the render or back to the main process, or, excuse me, I can access some APIs on the main process through a object called remote. So that's the approach I took for this, was just to invoke the dialog API from the main process through remote. And you can see what that looks like. I would really recommend reading about that. But here's the code that does that. We're just requiring an Electron and pulling remote out of that. So Carlos, here, this is, you were asking about the IPC stuff. Here's where we're sending our publishing, our login successful event. This guy right here, sorry, it's so hard to see back there. The login successful, and then we just push using React Router at this point to push to our beater journal. So this is all through React. This has nothing to do with, the routing isn't using Electron at all right now. We're just using standard web technologies that we're that I'm familiar with at this point. And then this component is handling its own state. So not to talk about React too much, but just to show you guys what's going on. This is using its own state, which has an email, password, and a loading active key that it flips back and forth. Okay, so let's go look at login. Nope, actually, let's go look at the beer journal app. I'll try to make this the last thing I show you guys. So this, I don't want to, do you guys want to know about the React piece, the stuff that's in here? There's just a little bit of React stuff going on. We have, again, state where we're storing a journal entry. The journal entry is based, we have a base, an initial journal entry state that we're storing as a constant, and then we just, that's the spread syntax right here. You guys are familiar with this in JavaScript. It's like doing object.assign, but it's just this little nice ES6 goodness to give us the spread syntax to create a copy of our object. Just has primitives in there, so we're just doing a pretty shallow copy at this point. We have loading active again, false, and we have an empty array for our journal entries. That's what you're seeing on the left navigation pane there. So on component did mount, I mentioned this earlier, I went back through a lot of code on how to get this to work the best way, because I was in my component did mount, I was firing off an asynchronous request for my access token, and then I wasn't getting the access token back right away, and I was getting some weird trying to set state on an unmounted component, all of that annoying stuff that you can run into. So my fix for it was to use the synchronous process. And this is, right here is an example of how you do that. So this is me invoking the, publishing the request access token event synchronously on the up to the main process. And then just to show you that code again, the main process right down here is responding to that. Using the storage utility to go get our token and return that back to us.
You're saying if you do a sync, you can't return anything even asynchronously.
Well,
you have another event.
Yeah. So when I was reading through their API documentation, it was showing with the asynchronous communication, you're basically publishing, subscribing, publishing, subscribing, something like that. So I'll dig in a little more into that, but it looked like that was the pattern that they were using. Absolutely, yeah, absolutely. I think some of that stuff will probably be more apparent the deeper I dive into this stuff. So then we're just issuing a GET using our fetch utility I showed you guys earlier. And again, to recap, I'm not advocating for this approach. I think that Electron has APIs that handles this stuff for us. I just rolled with Node fetch because I'm super familiar with it, and it was easy for me to do. I'm just making a request to on the top line here to our journal, our default journal route. Passing in the access token. The fetch utility handles that and creates an appropriate authorization header with the bearer token, including that access, the bearer prefix, including our access token. And then on success of that GET, we set the journal entries onto our state as well as the access token.
That's where you hit the database
right here. That is correct. So let me show you the fetch utility real quick. So this GET right here, this is the code, the GET in the post, or the code that GET the journal entries and GET our user, the post is what's posting our user information. The GET is what's getting our journal entries for us. So this is hitting, so the URL is being imported, being passed in. It's coming from our constants I showed you guys earlier. There's an environment constant and an endpoint constant. These guys right here. So pulls in our API path from the environment constant, and it exports a default object that has a user object and a journal object, and those are just storing our endpoints for us. So we get the full path back at this point. So the endpoint is our development environment slash, you know, user, or production environment slash user, QA environment slash user. That was my intention behind this. So fetch again, just doing super simple stuff. I just put a really quick helper function down here called set headers. Called set headers that checks for an access token. If it's there, it adds a authorization header, just a standard JWT authorization header or bearer token approach, if you guys are familiar with that. All right, so let's go back to the beer journal code. So logout, again, I'm sending a asynchronous event at this time saying request logout. Really, it's kind of pointless. Our app doesn't even check if a user is already authenticated by looking at something, maybe on the web in local storage. When the user refreshes or loads up the app, you might check local storage for a token and just make some assumptions based on that. Kind of pointless here, but I'm just clearing it out for example purposes. And then when you log out, we redirect ourselves back to the root, the home, which is just the slash here. And then other code in here is we're selecting journal entries. When you click on something, we're displaying it. I had to do some funky workaround stuff, if you look in here, to properly set the date inside of the HTML5 date picker. I'm not using a React component for that. It's just pure HTML5. I think, Cal, you might have ran into this. They work too. It's just so if you look at that code, that's why. Some helper functions for state. And then here's when you save a journal entry. This turns on our loader at the top. We set our state, loading active true. We do a post to our journal, our default journal entry route. We pass the journal entry that the user has created. We also pass the access token. On success of that, we're not using the response from the database. We're just kind of optimistically adding whatever the user typed in back into the journal entries array. So I'm not worried about what the database has sent back to me at this point. We clear out the journal entry the user's typed in. We make a copy of that initial journal entry, and then we pop the snack bar, which is the last line of code there. Then we also have some error handling. Then the rest of this is just React presenting our whole journal page, iterating through the journal entries in state, things like that, presenting all that. And this is all just Material Design Lite. That's what all these class names are, all the MDL-card. It's all just Material Design Lite built-in classes that help us get this nice, hopefully what you guys think is nice look and feel out of the box. But again, it looks very much like the web. So not sure if it's the best, but it works for it to me. That's pretty much it. I know it was a lot of content. The blog post, actually, sorry, before we wrap up, let me just quickly show you guys the what's missing piece real quick. I started writing this up last night a little bit because there's so much I wanted to do and so much I wanted to explore that I just didn't have time and I couldn't get to. This is the list of what I saw so far for what's missing and things that I wanted to do. So you can't edit a beer journal entry right now, which is kind of annoying. We can't package our app for deployment yet. We can't create a new user from the UI. Using the Electron library for HTTP requests. This is interesting too. So I'm using React scripts for hot module reloading inside of the React piece. But that's completely separate from the Electron piece. So Webpack has no idea about Electron at this point. So if I make a change in my Electron app, the hot module reloading doesn't pick that up.
What do you have to do for, like, let's say you make a change, do you have to restart it?
So in this, how this stands today, yeah, you just kill npm start and fire it back up.
Okay, so it's just like a normal process.
Yep, absolutely. So I was trying to get that whole hot module reloading into this, and I had a huge aha, like, oh boy, moment at the end, right? Where I had to still go through that same process. So I was thinking maybe I would just get rid of React scripts completely and use, like the Git Kraken folks have a super fast file watcher that they've built. I was thinking maybe I would just use NodeMon or something like that to watch for changes, and just kind of build a simple little process to take care of it.
Even with the hot module reloading, it doesn't change everything. So sometimes you have to like refresh your page.
Oh, browser. So the React piece does do that, yeah. So it refreshes for you. if you make a JavaScript change, but the Electron piece still doesn't do that.
Okay.
So the React piece does, but the Electron piece doesn't.
So it does a full page refresh?
It does a full page refresh, yeah.
Oh, okay.
The CSS, well, the CSS, yeah, sorry, for the clarification, the CSS is hot module reloaded, it swaps it in, you don't even see anything happen. The JavaScript actually causes the page to refresh.
So it's like what we have at work, basically.
It's just React scripts out of the box, basically, yep. So also, kind of what Carlos and I were just talking about, I'm really into building process flows, right? So I would really like to build my own React scripts kind of thing, but for Electron, where that uses more of a node-based approach to watch for file changes, make those refreshes for you, and all that good stuff. Also, I don't have any testing in place right now. There's no testing. I'm a big fan of Mocha and Chai, but any framework, but I'd like to get unit tests in here and feel how that works. Maybe do something like Redux for state management. Might be overkill, still thinking it through. And then right now, if you log in, if anybody logged in, they would see all the journal entries that I made. Right now, it's just grabbing everything. So I'd like to filter that by user. And then other stuff, because I know there's a bunch of other stuff to do. So, but again, that's pretty much it. My goal is to have the blog post done in like 3 or 4 weeks. Hopefully on the earlier side of that, and have a nice article that has all of this stuff wrapped up and tightening up all these screws. So hope you guys enjoyed. Thank you for coming. Appreciate it. You guys have any questions about anything? No?
I think Redux would work nice. You could have the dispatch kind of like hooked into the
IPC? Yeah,
so
for sure.
Dispatch, you can actually dispatch it to the other side also. And when you do something from the other side, you can get listed by the event by reproducers.
Yeah, so it kind of abstracts that away a little bit, right? So that's kind of what I was thinking. Maybe use sagas to give it a little less boilerplate, things like that. So it's fun. I want to keep building this thing out, man. Yeah.
Do you know how any of the inner workings of like VS Code or Postman or like how do they design their things?
Yeah.
Are they doing it this way?
Are they using webs? Right, because there has to be some slick development. So that had my wheels turning for development and like user experience, right?
Are they really web development inside of this?
Right.
Or they
I think they're taking more of a pure native approach and focused on Node. You know, I don't know. I'd like to. Maybe there's some articles out there about how we did this or something. The VS Code. Do you guys use VS Code? Anybody? Like, I'm a huge WebStorm guy, but VS Code, I'm super impressed with how fast this thing is. I mean, this is what Electron gives us, right? It's like this, I got really, really, really excited about this because it's super snappy, does lots of cool stuff, and it's all just JavaScript.
What's the business with knockouts?
What's that?
What's the business with knockouts?
You think so?
Just joking, because the C# was always like that.
It's in TypeScript.
I heard that. That really hurts my face. That makes me not like it.
Just
kidding. There's definitely legit reasons. I'm totally kidding. I'd be super curious to hear what these guys, especially their development flow, right? How do they? Because I'm sure this is a big team that built this. How's their day-to-day dev experience, right? What are they doing for simple things like development builds?
Is it open source? VS Code?
Maybe.
I think Adam is.
Yeah, Adam definitely is. Let's do a quick internet. I've heard before they used this. They used TypeScript on this, so that could. I don't know if you guys were kidding, but I think that's a real thing. Yeah. So this looks like the code right here. That's pretty cool. So. I'm gonna fork this bad boy too and see what's going on. So they're using Gulp instead of Webpack, which makes sense because they're not. They probably have a bunch of monster tasks to build all this thing.
Types.
Yes. Yep. So they're using. that's enough. Presentation.
So if you want your Electron apps to run fast, build them in TypeScript.
Sure. I don't condone that approach. But